Morning. Welcome to worship on this fifth Sunday after Epiphany. Those who brave the cold to come out, but isn't it beautiful and bright? So you're not going to get a brighter day than this. Hope everybody got dug out properly. Just a couple announcements this morning. We are in the season of Epiphany, the light of Christ, the manifestation of his glory. Each week we get a little different glimpse and picture of it. We have on our calendar Wednesday choir resuming 6:30, and so the numbers are starting to look a bit more favorable from this virus, and so choir is going to be resuming. Still ask people, especially who are vulnerable, to take the extra measures needed. On Thursday we have council. We'll meet here in the sanctuary. AA will be in the fellowship hall, so that's on Thursday evening. Is there anything else that needs to be highlighted at this time? If not, would you please rise as we join in confession and absolution. We gather as always in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Almighty God, to whom all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hid, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. If we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves and the truth is not in us. But if we confess our sins, God, who is faithful and just, will forgive our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Please kneel or sit as we take time in personal reflection. Most merciful God, we confess that we are in bondage to sin and cannot free ourselves. We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us. Forgive us, renew us, and lead us, so that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways to the glory of your holy name. Amen. In the mercy of Almighty God, Jesus Christ was given to die for us, and for his sake God forgives us all of our sins. As a called and ordained minister of the Church of Christ, by his authority, I therefore declare unto you the entire forgiveness of all your sins, in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. The peace of the Lord be with you always. Let's share the peace as best we can these days. And like that beautiful sunshine outside, we will sing, Awake My Soul and With the Sun.
Thank you.
grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Let us pray. Holy Lord, in your loving kindness, you have poured on us grace upon grace. It was by your wisdom that we were created, and by your power that we have been called into discipleship in Christ Jesus. Help us to be fishers of people, fully devoted to you, so that all will know your abiding love. We pray this in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. We hear the word of the Lord.
A reading from Isaiah. In the year that King Uzziah died, I saw the Lord sitting upon a throne, high and lifted up, and the train of his robe filled the temple. Above him stood the seraphim. Each had six wings. With two he covered his face, and with two he covered his feet, and with two he flew. And one called to another and said, "Holy, holy, holy is the Lord of hosts. The whole earth is full of his glory." And the foundations of the threshold shook at the voice of him who called, and the voice in the house was filled with smoke. And I said, "Woe is me, for I am lost, for I am a man of unclean lips, and I dwell in the midst of a people of unclean lips. For my eyes have seen the King, the Lord of hosts." Then one of the seraphim flew to me, having in his hand a burning coal that he had taken with tongs from the altar. And he touched my mouth and said, "Behold, this has touched your lips. Your guilt is taken away and your sin atoned for." And I heard the voice of the Lord saying, "Whom shall I send, and who will go for us?" Then I said, "Here I am, send me." And he said, "Go and say to this people, keep on hearing, but do not understand. Keep on seeing, but do not perceive. Make the heart of this people dull, and their ears heavy, and blind their eyes, lest they see with their eyes, and hear with their ears, and understand with their hearts, and turn and be healed." Then I said, "How long, O Lord?" And he said, "Until cities lie waste without inhabitant, and houses without people, and the land is a desolate waste. And the Lord removes people far away, and the forsaken places are many in the midst of the land. And though a tenth remain in it, it will be burned again, like the terebinth or an oak, whose stump remains when it is felled. The holy seed is its stump." The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
We will now read responsibly Psalm 138. I will give thanks to you, O Lord, with my whole heart. Before the gods, I will sing your praise.
I will bow down toward your holy temple and praise your name because of your love and faithfulness.
For you have glorified your name and your word above all things.
When I called, you answered me.
You increased my strength within me. All the kings of the earth will praise you, O Lord, when they have heard the words of your mouth.
They will sing the ways of the Lord, that great is the glory of the Lord.
Though the Lord be high, he cares for the lowly. He perceives the haughty from afar.
Though I walk in the midst of trouble, you keep me safe. You stretch forth your hand against the fury of my enemies. Your right hand shall save me.
The Lord will make good his purpose for me. O Lord, your love endures forever. Do not abandon the works of your hand. A reading from 1 Corinthians. Strive to excel in the building of the church. Therefore, one who speaks in a tongue should pray that he may interpret. For if I pray in a tongue, my spirit prays that my mind is unfruitful. What am I to do? I will pray with my spirit, but I will pray with my mind also. I will sing praise with my spirit, but I will sing with my mind also. Otherwise, if you give thanks with your spirit, how can anyone in the position of an outsider say, Amen, to your thanksgiving when he does not know what you are saying. For you may be giving thanks well enough, but the other person is not being built up. I thank God that I speak in tongues more than all of you. Nevertheless, in church I would rather speak 5 words with my mind in order to instruct others than 10,000 words in a tongue. Brothers, do not be children in your thinking. Be infants in evil, but in your thinking be mature. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Gospel according to St. Luke, the 5th chapter.
Glory to you, Lord.
On one occasion, while the crowd was pressing in on Jesus to hear the word of God, he was standing by the lake of Gennesaret, and he saw 2 boats by the lake, but the fishermen had gone out of them and were washing their nets. Getting into one of the boats, which was Simon's, he asked him to put out a little from the land, and he sat down and taught the people from the boat. And when he had finished speaking, he said to Simon, "Put out into the deep and let down your nets for a catch." And Simon answered, "Master, we toiled all night and took nothing, but at your word, I will let down the nets." And when they had done this, they enclosed a large number of fish, and their nets were breaking. They signaled to their partners in the other boat to come and help them. And they came and filled both the boats so that they began to sink. But when Simon Peter saw it, he fell down at Jesus' knees saying, "Depart from me, for I am a sinful man, O Lord." For he and all who were with him were astonished at the catch of fish that they had taken. And so also were James and John, sons of Zebedee, who were partners with Simon. And Jesus said to Simon, "Do not be afraid. From now on, you will be catching men." And when they had brought their boats to land, they left everything and followed him. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord.
Please be seated. Dear brothers and sisters in Christ, grace to you and peace from God our Father, and from the Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. For today's sermon, I'd actually like to work through that gospel lesson, Luke 5, 1 to 11. So if you even want to hold it in your hand, we're going to go verse by verse. Sometimes it's helpful to look at it and go back to it. The calling of the first disciples, an interesting moment in Scripture. God's word is living also, so we know that it will have something that speaks to us as well. Since we're going to the lake, also known the Sea of Galilee, we might as well jump right in. Verse 1. On one occasion, while the crowd was pressing in on him to hear the word of God, Jesus was standing by the lake of Gennesaret. Doesn't that location sound nice right about now? By a lake on a warm day? Almost rubbing it in, wouldn't you say? Well, maybe we can't be there physically, but as we listen, we can go there in our minds and escape the cold for a few minutes. And there's Jesus, and there's the lake, and there's the crowd which we join. So we come together, and it says they were pressing in to hear God's word from Christ. Who were these people? There are so many individuals in this crowd. How far had they come that day? What were they expecting? Their answers may have differed to a lot of those things, but they all focused on the one Lord. So all those people coming with their different thoughts and experiences, but it was the one Lord in common. The incarnate Word was walking the earth, through whom all things were made, as Colossians tells us in John chapter 1. All things were made through him. The land, the lake, the morning sunlight, the seagulls crying out over the water, all those people who had gathered, all of them made through the word that spoke from the beginning and now walked on the earth. It's no wonder they were pressing and drawing close to him, for there was power in this word. A question for us, though, is whether or not modern people are even capable of listening as closely as that ancient crowd did. What do you think? They lived in a world with less noise. There were no motors, no jets flying overhead, no huge surround sound home theaters, things like this. No Twitter feeds so I get the last word. It was kind of a quiet world except for natural sounds and the human voice. I wonder, along with all the changes that have come, what's happened to patience over the ages? You think we're as patient as people were once upon a time? I have my doubts. The crowd in the gospel was pressing in. They wanted to hear Jesus as if their lives depended on it. His strong word cuts through all narcissism, every last bit of earthly pomposity, like a two-edged sword wielded by the Holy Spirit. That's why they were pressing in. He spoke with authority. Verse 2, and he saw two boats by the lake, but the fishermen had gone out of them and were washing their nets. Here's an interesting question. Had those fishermen intentionally quit their work for the day in order to draw near to Jesus? Or were they simply in the right place at the right time? They're listening, but they were tending to their nets after a long night of fruitless labor. It's kind of an interesting question. I highlight it because it just might be that they could represent a different set of ears. There were those who came just to hear Jesus and then hear the fishermen coming in from the lake. They might represent this world's busy souls, exhausted, a little defeated, trying to do their best, but kind of coming up empty. That sound like people of our day, perhaps? Maybe we have a lot of ears like that in our time. People who just are really struggling to hold all these things together, their life, and so on. They're interested, but they're overwhelmed. And either they were never taught to look for God's word, or they just kind of fell away amid the confusions and the delusions and the spiritual pummeling of modern life. Maybe you had somebody pop into your mind just now. We'll get to you being a fisherman later. However we analyze it, the fishermen in Luke 5 were the recipients of an opportunity that would change the course of their lives. Sometimes the person seeks out the message. Sometimes the message finds the person. Here we are. We are on the sending side of Pentecost. We believe in the priesthood of all believers so that God's word is going to go out into the world. It's going to go into homes and schools and hospitals, factories, offices, nursing homes, you name it. But the listening has to come first. If we are going to have a saving word that actually meets people where they're at, if we're going to glorify God and not ourselves, then we have to be good, deep listeners and understand. Then we have a saving word to share. So we say to ourselves, be still, my soul. Speak, Lord, for your servant is listening. Verse 3, getting into one of the boats, which was Simon's, he asked him to put out a little from the land, and he sat down and taught the people from the boat. What a beautiful scene that was. We can almost hear the morning waves lapping up against the boat. And there you got Jesus out there. You got the people, they were crowding in. They probably lined up all along the shoreline, And of course, the Lord made acoustics, so he knew that his voice would carry over the water, and he could get a whole bunch of people this way. May all that water also remind us of the first creation when God said, "Let there be," and the new creation in the waters of baptism by God's word and the Holy Spirit. As for Simon, notice that Jesus did not press him too hard, not from the start, not right away. Just all he said was, "Put out a little from the land." Simon's initial investment was minimal, just his time and his boat. Now who was doing the fishing? Simon was being drawn in as surely as the morning sun was rising on a new day. Verse 4. And when he had finished speaking, he said to Simon, "Put out into the deep and let down your nets for a catch." Suddenly, the request from the Lord went from small and modest to a fairly major inconvenience. Perhaps Simon still thought that he was doing a favor for the Lord. You know, "Can you go out and do this for me?" "Sure, we can do that, we can do that." What he didn't know is that it was exactly the opposite. The Lord was about to show this fisherman that the kingdom of heaven was far bigger than he thought, and it was far more closely at hand than he knew. The fact of the matter is that Simon needed to be stunned by a moment of awe. He needed to be overwhelmed by humility, really, so that he could be of actual service to the Lord's mission to a proud and broken world. This is how Simon would learn to serve best. Verse 5. Simon answered. He's not quite where he will be. So he first answers, "Master, we toiled all night and took nothing. But at your word, I will let down the nets." Do you hear it in there? Like trying to get a kid to clean their room or something. Not real eager. The call of Simon involved the overturning of what he considered his greatest strength. Did you hear that? Fishing and nets, he understood. That very lake he knew. He knew probably every shelf, every hole, where the little fish go in the heat of the day to hide in the cool spots. He would have known it all. This was what he did. By the way, this would not be Simon's last lesson in faithfulness out on the water. He had a lot of them. It's just that this one in particular struck to the heart of his own sense of logic and actually his expertise. This is what he was good at. So it appears that, at least at the start, he was only obeying the letter of Christ's command. Don't forget also, he was all night exhausted. If you've ever worked a night shift, and then the next day, you don't get to go to bed, you get a little glimpse into what Peter was feeling right about now. His head was looking for a pillow. "But at your word, I will let down the nets." Verse 6. And when they had done this, let down the nets, they enclosed a large number of fish, and their nets were breaking. This was a teachable moment, as they say. Later in the gospel, we'll hear about loaves and fish. This is about fish, fish, and more fish. But what it's really about is the realization that Jesus was and is and ever shall be the Son of God from eternity, the maker of the fish and the birds of the air. It was the great humbling before the calling. Or would it be better to say that the humbling was actually a crucial aspect of the calling? I kind of think that's right. The person has got to be set straight in order for the mission to be handled correctly. If the apostle was not firmly grounded, the mission would go astray. So the clarity and the humility came first. Verse 7. They signaled to their partners in the other boat to come and help them. They came and filled both the boats so that they began to sink. Again, Simon had a history of sinking in the presence of the Lord of the wind and the waves. Verse 8. But when Simon Peter saw it, he fell down at Jesus' knees, saying, "Depart from me, for I am a sinful man, O Lord." For he and all who were with him were astonished at the catch of fish that they had taken. So those reluctant words that he had said before were coming back to haunt him now. If Peter had understood this beforehand, he would not have been so reluctant. But the fact is, of the matter is that we all start right where we start. Evangelism is relational. Begins with real people where they're at. So we all know somebody who could use a closer encounter with God. Maybe it's ourselves right now. Maybe it's somebody who popped into your head. But how do we assist in God working out his plan? Notice that Jesus did not overwhelm Peter all at once. First, the Lord just had him get in the boat with him. Just put out a little bit. Just get in the boat with me. Come on. And listen. Next, he called Simon to go deeper. Then came the relaunch of all those cleaned and folded nets. A little bit more investment, taking a huge one, actually. And finally, the great realization that turned into a confession. Where the fishermen had felt put upon by Jesus earlier in the passage, he now realized whom he was encountering and what it meant. And so those words, "Depart from me, O Lord." It's like Isaiah in the first lesson when he got a glimpse of the reality of heaven and he says, "Woe is me, I'm in trouble, and we're all in trouble." And then came the cleansing. What we need, first and foremost, is to comprehend how things actually stand. Not just our earthly standing, you know, in relation to other people or this kind of thing or our attitude about this, but how we stand in the grand scheme of eternity. This universe was made by God himself for a purpose. So we need to understand how things really do stand. And we understand this best not when we're standing, but when we're kneeling. God, we remember our baptism and confession each week. That is a kind of a call to remember the forgiveness that's there. God is going to wash away arrogance like a remnant of the original sin again and again and again. And then redeemed souls will recognize their place in the grand scheme of things and become open and willing vessels for God's will in their own lives and how to be helpful to others. But it was that moment of truth when Peter finally confessed, "I am a sinful man. I am a sinful man." That began his life of discipleship. He would serve to the glory of God alone, not himself. 10a. And so also were James and John, astonished, sons of Zebedee, who were partners with Simon. This was the same James and John who, with their imaginations full of glory, are later going to ask to be at the right and left hand of Christ in his glory. All right? Some lessons need to be learned more than once before they take hold. Sorry, guys, it's not about the glory. But if you want to suffer with me, I'll give you that. And then there will be glory one day, but it's going to be the glory of Christ. So they had their lessons they were going to have to learn again. Nevertheless, they followed Jesus after the astonishing catch. So how about us in our discipleship, our walk of faith? Do we have everything figured out once and for all? Have you become perfect yet? I just take a little poll here. Okay. Might we make a mess of things at times? One of the beauties of the Gospels is that the apostles had to bear witness to what happened, so the glory of Christ, but they also showed their very own weaknesses. And so we find our place right in the scriptures. We're right there with them. But we also remember that the crucified and risen Lord, that his greatest act of power was a love so deep that he not only died at the hands of sinners, but he died on behalf of sinners. So we blow it, and we confess, and he immediately is there to lift us up. Verse 10b, and Jesus said to Simon, "Do not be afraid. From now on, you will be catching men." And when they had brought their boats to land, they left everything and followed him. Notice how far Simon traveled in just that one morning. His heart and mind were now captivated by the living Word who walked the earth in those most crucial days on earth. Peter was there for all of it. He would follow and be a witness. He would actually go on to serve and bear witness. He would even go on to lay down his life when the time came for it, because of Jesus, whose power and goodness had conquered sin, death, and the devil. Peter would serve an everlasting kingdom, and it would cost him his earthly life. That's how devoted he became. It's not where he started, that's where he ended. Two important notes about the apostles leaving everything. First, they followed Jesus and were faithful to their call. They were going back and forth. You read the Gospels. They're going from Galilee down to Jerusalem, back and forth. They even went up north and across the Sea of Galilee, wherever it took, but they were always kind of crisscrossing and then coming back. Witnesses of everything that Christ said and did. Their testimony becomes the basis for the New Testament. So the greatest beneficiary of them leaving everything and doing that is us. We've got the Word. It's all based, the whole New Testament is based upon apostolic authority. These are the beliefs. These are the teachings that matter. They had a holy calling. We are the greatest recipients. So that's part of when they left everything. They did it for us. There's another important point, though, that needs to be made. And I don't hear this much. But during this same time, we should not think that any of the apostles who were married abandoned those marriages or sought divorce. Traveling much for good reasons is one thing, but God is not going to tear asunder what he brought together. Sometimes I've read commentaries and I almost had the sense that they thought that they just dissolved all earthly relationships at this point. It is true that they left much of their former life behind. But even though they may have been separated from their loved ones during those crucial months and years as they were traveling back and forth with Jesus, they didn't dissolve those fundamental relationships. How do I know this with confidence? Don't we think the other, maybe? How about this from St. Paul? Years after Pentecost now, while Paul is defending himself from needless Corinthian critiques, he actually had to defend his own apostolic rights, including the following. Here's what he says. "This is my defense to those who would examine me. Do we not have the right to eat and drink? Do we not have the right to take along a believing wife? As do the other apostles and the brothers of the Lord, and Cephas," Peter. So it's important that we get a clear picture of what happened. This is 1 Corinthians 9, by the way, verses 3 through 5. Very clear witness in Scripture. So just to get it straight, because sometimes we read back from a later monasticism that took over, but this is the early church. After Pentecost, so after they followed Christ and all the sacrifices thereof, after Pentecost, when God's word is going out all over the world, the apostles traveled with their spouses. Wherever the Spirit called, earthly families served the greater good of God's family of faith. They all shared in the sacrifices and the blessings thereof. Each and every one of us, we have our various earthly callings, but together we are also called to be that family of faith, to serve the living Lord Jesus humbly and faithfully, and then to go out into all the world to others, like fishermen of old. Thanks be to God. Amen. Please rise as we sing, "You Have Come Down to the Lake Shore."
Thank you.
confess our Christian faith in the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Please be seated as we join in a time of prayer.
Let us pray. Almighty and everlasting God, all through the ages your call has come to people in mysterious ways, yet your word is clear. We are yours according to grace, and your Spirit makes us into faithful servants. Humble us, call us, and draw us deeper into the faith that follows Jesus and trusts his command. Inspire us to live as missionaries for your kingdom wherever we may be, beginning with our own homes and even our own hearts. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
We pray, O Lord, for the church to be mission-driven. Bless this congregation as a mission center. Bless our district Bishop Selbo, all NALC staff and ministries, our outreach partners, and all helpful organizations, as well as faithful brothers and sisters in other denominations. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
We pray, O Lord, for the needs of the world. Bless and keep all civil servants according to your holy will for the good of all. Bless and keep all who serve honorably in harm's way and their families. Where war and violence threaten, bring your peace, protection, and wisdom. May your will be done in our nation and all around the earth. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
We pray on behalf of those who need healing in any way. Strengthen and renew all health care workers in their ministry of healing. And hear as we pray for particular people at this time. Shelby Alexander, Morgan Bear, B. Breeden, Shannon Cromer, Shayla Dell, Samantha Sam Despain, Claude and Jane Dixon, Mark Emmerich, Carrie Giordano, Sally Hahn, Carmen Hasdorf, Kelly Hansen, Amy Mitchell, Caitlin Mountcastle, Roger Pierce, Kathy Patel, Andy and Susan Prochelle, Joe and Peggy Prochelle, Susan Root, Annabelle Shamel, Tom Shamel, Gordon Self, Jan Spittler, Dave Stevenson, Edie Turpin, Mike and Teddy Watkins, Becky Wokenberg, as well as those whom we name in our hearts. Into your hands, O Lord, we commend all for whom we pray, trusting in your mercy through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen.
Thank you.
Please rise as we sing the great Epiphany hymn, As with Gladness Men of Old. Let us pray. Blessed are you, O Lord, our God, maker of all things. Through your goodness, you have blessed us with these gifts. With them, we offer ourselves to your service and dedicate our lives to the care and redemption of all that you have made for the sake of him who gave himself for us, Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. In the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread, gave thanks, broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." Again, after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." And he taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. God's gifts for his people. May the body and blood of the Lord Jesus Christ strengthen you and keep you in his grace. Amen. Thank the Lord and sing his praise. Tell everyone what he has done. Let everyone who seeks the Lord rejoice and proudly bear his name. He recalls his promises and leads his people forth in joy with shouts of thanks. Let us pray. Pour out upon us the spirit of your love, O Lord, and unite the wills of those whom you have fed with one heavenly food. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Receive the benediction. May Almighty God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit bless you now and forever.
Amen.
Amen. We sing, appropriately enough, Spread, O Spread, Almighty Word.
Serve the Lord.
Thanks be to God.